Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation of colors and remain standing for the playing of the Chilean National Anthem in honor of Vice Admiral Alberto Soto, our Naval Postgraduate School Hall of Fame inductee, followed by the United States National Anthem. Color Guard, parade the colors. Color Guard, retire the colors. Our chaplain, Lieutenant Commander Matthew Four, will now deliver the invocation.
Let us pray. Almighty God, a long time ago, before many of us were born, a great band sang a song with wise words from an ancient text that I consider God-breathed, which says, "There is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep, a time to gain, a time to lose, a time to reign, a time of sow, a time of love, a time of hate, a time for peace. It's not too late." In this season of our lives, we spent many late nights pondering the implications of the degree, striving towards now, just moments away. And wherever the winds send us next, to sunny San Diego or towards the frozen chosen, may each graduate always remember the good times in Monterey and for what reason they were sent here. God, thank you for today's commencement and for the accomplishment of each graduate today. I ask that you would bless each one of them, grant them confidence for the upcoming challenges, and we especially implore, bestow upon them bountiful blessings upon their families and loved ones. As we honor them and their achievement today, may you, Lord, be honored as well. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Naval Postgraduate School's winter quarter graduation. Staring the stage with President Rondeau and Provost Gardner are our esteemed guest speaker, Vice Admiral John Mustin, Chief of Navy Reserve, Vice Admiral Alberto Soto, Commander of Naval Operations, Chilean Navy, Rear Admiral James Aiken, Commander U.S. Naval Forces Southern Command and Commander U.S. Fourth Fleet, the chairs of our academic departments, and our local military leadership who have been deeply involved in the education of today's graduates. As part of today's graduation ceremony, we're also honored to induct Vice Admiral Soto into the Naval Postgraduate School Hall of Fame. I would now like to introduce Dr. Scott Gardner, Provost of the Naval Postgraduate School.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's try that again.
Good morning.
All right, that's a lot better. All right, first off, let's congratulate our graduates. All right. There are a lot of important people up here on the stage, but you can be loud. That's all right. You can be enthusiastic. We're proud of what these graduates have accomplished, and we're excited to let them know about that. But graduates, you have a responsibility as well to be excited, enthusiastic, proud, and supportive, because you're here because of a couple teams of people who have helped you. So I would like you to help me recognize that. With the family members of those who have, and friends of graduates today, please rise. Graduates, would you join me in thanking your family and friends? Thank you. It's a team effort to make it through the Naval Postgraduate School's demanding requirements and classes and courses and thesis writing. One team, family and friends, another big team that shapes the experience of our graduates who are here, or the faculty and staff of the Naval Postgraduate School. Would the faculty and staff of the Naval Postgraduate School, military and civilian, please rise? Y'all are faculty, come on. Excellent, thank you very much. As graduates, you have leapt off a mountain. To do that, you had to do two things. The first was to climb the mountain. For many of you, you had to go through the intellectual version of what the SEALs call Hell Week, right? Climbing that mountain. Maybe it was a math class, a theory class, a statistics class, Something that around week three or four, you turned to a friend or a family member, a spouse, a roommate, and said, no way, this ain't happening. And yet you made it through. You dug deep down, you found that you had abilities maybe you didn't realize you had, and you climbed that mountain. And for that, you should be congratulated. But you did more. You leapt off the mountain. And let me tell you what I mean by that. Think about today, how rare it is for us not to be able to get the answer to a question. What's the population of Ukraine? That'd be about 43 million. What's the boiling point of lithium, a critical element in batteries for electric vehicles? That'd be about 2,500 degrees. I looked those up on Google, like we all do, right? Knowledge is easily available. We don't ask questions so often where we don't know the answer. Our graduates did. They asked questions for which you could not Google the answer, you could not ChatGPT the answer. It was not clear what the answer was. They had to go and figure it out. What that meant was they transformed themselves from a knowledge and information consumer to a knowledge and information explorer, a scientist, a researcher, a scholar. They leapt off the mountain. They did not know where they would land. And that's truly extraordinary. And by doing that, they learned how to navigate uncharted territory, uncharted knowledge, a skill that's going to be tremendously useful for them as leaders over the future of their career. They learned how to transform uncertainty into innovation. Another critical skill for the Navy, Marine Corps, military services, and allies. They climbed and they leapt. And we're proud of them. Well done. In doing so, they form friendships with a variety of different teammates. Today you'll see over the graduation all kinds of uniforms, all kinds of countries, tremendous variation in diversity. It's a strength of NPS, and graduates, that social network is a strength of yours now. I encourage you to maintain it, to curate it, to work it, to keep those friends and connections, because you'll never know when an alum is going to be a really big deal downstream, and you might need their help or support, or they might need yours. I'm very proud of you and what you've accomplished today. I'm thrilled that your family and friends are here to see and recognize and champion your tremendous accomplishments. Graduates, congratulations.
I'm now honored to introduce the president of the Naval Postgraduate School, Vice Admiral Anne Rondeau, United States Navy, retired.
Good morning. What a great day. These days are always a day of celebration and excellence and of joy by our faculty, by our staff, and by our graduates. What a great day and a day of gratitude. So let me first start off with the gratitude and extend it to what the provost said today. I want to thank the provost, the faculty, and the staff for what they do every day to support our graduates as you go out to become the extraordinary leaders and continue to do that as you have been. I also want to thank the Del Monte Brass. These are all volunteers. They do this on their own for the love of the mission and their attraction and their loyalty to NPS. A round of applause for our Monterey Brass. I also want to thank the foundation, the NPS Foundation. They are an extraordinary group also of volunteers and a small paid staff that do enormous work around the globe to advance the alumni cause for NPS as well as the donor cause for NPS. I would like to have the CEO, Rich Paston, please stand and thanks to him. In the audience today, we are privileged to have with us two visiting attachés joining in the celebration of their country's graduates. And if you would please stand, Colonel Salim El Khalid Abdelli. The colonel is the attaché in the military office of the Embassy of Algeria, and sir, it's very, very nice to have you here, sir. And Lieutenant Commander Wayne McCall, please stand. He is the Australian attaché for officer training in the Embassy of Australia. Very nice to have you here, sir, as well. Okay, so graduates, this is your day. And what we're going to do is talk about the meaning of NPS to that thing that the provost talked about, and that was networking amongst all of you as we first do this first event. So this is about you. It's also about the alumni whose spirits and whose legacies and whose performance came before you. So we're going to celebrate your achievements in a moment, but also think about yourself and yourselves as we do this next ceremony. So for our commencement speaker, we have Vice Admiral John Mustin, the Chief of Navy Reserves, who is a 1996 graduate with a degree in operations research. We'll talk more about him in a moment. We have an additional special event, though, for today's ceremony. We're very pleased and honored to have with us Vice Admiral Alberto Soto Valenzuela, who is a 2000 graduate of NPS with a degree in operations research. Vice Admiral Soto is the commander of the Chilean Navy, and under his leadership, his Navy has grown to become a premier naval force in SOUTHCOM and in PAYCOM, in both the Southern Hemisphere and the Indo-Pacific Theater. And think about this. He leads a Navy with a country of a 4,000-mile border all along the ocean. 4,000 miles north to south, south to north, is a coastline for this country. This is a serious Navy, and he has been the leader who has advanced that Navy in so many ways. And so all of the challenges that we have in the world and in the globe, we have been in alliance and partnership with Chile for many, many years. And our first graduate from Chile, from the Navy of Chile, was here in 1954. We've had 70 of their graduates and of their leaders ever since. So in recognition of his accomplishments and his extraordinary leadership, today Vice Admiral Soto will receive the highest honor that we can bestow upon an NPS graduate. He will be inducted today in front of you into the NPS Hall of Fame. Now he's the first Chilean graduate to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. We've had only Venezuela, Singapore, and Thailand. Thank you. So we have the fourth now in the entire life of NPS. His thesis, oh, by the way, has a great title: The Flaming Datum Problem with Varying Speed. Yeah, okay. So when you look at Calhoun and at his thesis description, the abstract, it says this: the objective of this thesis is to explore the idea of varying speed in the flaming datum problem. With the flaming datum, though, is a problem of detecting an enemy submarine whose possible position was revealed by the hit of a torpedo, which is known as a flaming datum problem. And he used an analytical method. He used a discrete event simulation tool, and he looked at the effects on the detection probability. This is a serious work done by a serious professional naval officer, and it still has resonance today. So let's talk about the Hall of Fame some more. This is not something that, when you go into Herman Hall, look on the Hall of Fame wall. there were some extraordinary leaders there. Admiral Mike Mullen, General Mike Hagee, who was a former commandant of the Marine Corps, Vice Admiral Jan Tighe, who was the first, who commanded the 10th Fleet as the first woman to be a numbered fleet commander. The Honorable Everett Alvarez, a Navy Vietnam POW for 8 years and who remained in public service, rising to Deputy Director of the Peace Corps and the Veterans Administration. And the list goes on. Vice Admiral Soto is amongst those kinds of distinguished alumni and graduates. This is also an extraordinarily good man. Listening to him at breakfast, getting to know him, it is an honor to know a leader who cares so deeply for his country, for his Navy, for his citizens, for his people, for freedom and democracy, for the free market and exchange of ideas, who comes to this work and knowing us as a very profoundly committed critic and also supporter. This is the kind of critical leader that he is. So now I'm going to ask our 4th Fleet Commander, Rear Admiral Jim Aitken, to come up and talk some more about this good man and to introduce Vice Admiral Soto. Admiral Aitken, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Admiral Rondeau. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be the one who gets to introduce my friend. It's someone that I've learned a lot from. A leader of leaders. But before I go any further, let me first of all say congrats to all of you. What a significant day, and I applaud your efforts, your energy, and certainly thank your families as well. In my brief remarks today, I'm going to channel my inner Abraham Lincoln when he said in the Gettysburg Address, "Few will remember what was said here today." So with that in mind, I will keep my remarks very brief. However, I should applaud my staff because they actually came up with 6 pages of introduction. So if I did all of this, it would probably be longer than Admiral Soto's speech, and really you all came to hear him and not me today. So in my few moments with you today, I could highlight what the great leader Admiral Soto is, the great partner he is, the innovator that he is, the thinker that he is. And all those things are covered in your program so you can read those. What's not in your program is the journey that got him here. He is the son of a master chief, and he has been able to achieve vice admiral rank in his Navy. He is well respected. Now, I will tell you, having spent a significant amount of time in South America and Central America, this typically doesn't happen. Admirals beget admirals. Senior officers beget senior officers. This is the first instance that I've ever heard of a master chief having a son who has achieved the rank of vice admiral. That just shows you the special family, the lineage that he comes from. And this morning at breakfast, we talked about not necessarily leaving a legacy, because leaving a legacy is about us. We talked about passing on a legacy. And as I close today, my goal is just to say thank you. Thank you for passing on a legacy, and not just to you, Admiral, but I know your father is watching, and I want to thank that Master Chief who instilled the values that he did in you, the hard work, the dedication, the embracing everyone. I want to thank him first, and then secondly, I want to thank you for all that you've done for our partnership, for leading your Navy, for being an innovator, for being a friend, for being critical and challenging me, and challenging the U.S. Navy to be better. So with that, I introduce my dear friend, my colleague, and the newest inductee to the Naval Postgraduate Hall of Fame, Admiral Soto.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand. Attention to award. Naval Postgraduate School Hall of Fame, presented to Vice Admiral Alberto Soto, Vice Admiral, Chilean Navy, 24 March 2023. Vice Admiral Alberto Soto Valenzuela of the Chilean Navy began his career in 1982. He completed operational assignments on Chilean Navy frigates Almirante Riveros and Almirante Lynch. Vice Admiral Soto later served as the commander Task Force 176.1 during RIMPAC 2012, and then headed the Strategic Planning Department at Joint Chiefs of Staff, head of the Plans Department of the General Staff of the Navy, and Commander-in-Chief of the 4th Naval Zone. In 2000, Vice Admiral Soto graduated from the Naval Postgraduate School with a Master of Science in Operations Research. Vice Admiral Soto leveraged his education to significantly impact the effectiveness of Chilean Navy operations and elevated his service to become a premier Navy in the U.S. Southcom area of operations. In 2020, he was selected as Commander of Naval Operations for the Chilean Navy and promoted to Vice Admiral. Under his astute leadership, the Chilean Navy participated in multiple fleet exercises, tactical development events, and combined operations with the U.S. Navy and U.S. Coast Guard as part of the Joint Interagency Task Force South. As Commander of Naval Operations, he directed the Chilean Navy's participation in multiple cooperative deployments, including the highly successful Pacific Ocean deployments of the frigate Blanco Encalda and the oiler Almirante Montt. Vice Admiral Soto's exemplary and remarkable leadership and service to his country is commendable and distinguishes him as an exceptional graduate and ambassador for the Naval Postgraduate School. Signed, Andy Rondeau, Vice Admiral, USN, retired, President. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. And it's my honor to introduce Vice Admiral Alberto Soto.
Well, let me start by saying that I still hate the flaming datum problem. I still hate it. Well, I have a speech, but I'm going to take a risk because life is about taking risks too. Who's the least senior graduate today? The least senior, the youngest one. Who's an ensign graduating? O2. Who's an O2 graduating? O3. Who's the? Okay, you are the final line. So please rise. Yeah, you. Yeah, well. So what's your name? What's your names again?
Wesley Norton.
Norton.
Yes.
Okay. Are you married, Norton?
Yes, sir.
Are your family here?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for supporting this guy. And by talking to Norton, okay, I was expressing my will to talk and to touch your heart, every single one of you, because he's the lead senior, okay? He doesn't matter because he's senior, you know. Almost 23 years ago, I was sitting in the same place where you are, and close to me was Major Wei Yamada, U.S. Army. I say, who? Major Wei Yamada, U.S. Army. Who later had a very scary escape from the Pentagon on 9/11, 2001. And he was also Major Tim Maxwell, U.S. Marines, who was seriously wounded in Iraq and had a very impressive history of recovery from a brain surgery. And he was my classmate and friend, Major Paul Finken, who was killed by a roadside bomb in November 2, 2006, while in a mission of training Iraqi army units. My feelings, and I could not start without saying this, in this moment, are with his spouse, Jackie, and his three daughters, Emily, Caroline, and Julia. So I want you to ask you something. Please rise, and let's have a moment of silence in honor of Lieutenant Colonel U.S. Army Paul Finken, my classmate and graduate of the summer 2000 class of operations research of this Naval Postgraduate School. Fallen Paul but never forgotten. Sit, please. In this wonderful moment of your graduation, I just gave you a dramatic moment of realism. Life is many times difficult, and things not always work in the way we want or dream. That's the truth. Good morning, distinguished officers, winter 2023 graduates of the Naval Postgraduate School. I am Vice Admiral Soto of the Chilean Navy. Until last December, I was the commander of Naval Operations of the Navy. And I'm also an operational research alumni who graduated in the summer of 2000. As an average operational research student, I have to say that this moment, it is unique for me. And expressing this in this rare event in terms of likelihood, I should admit that only a month ago, the probability that I, a naval officer ready to retire after 41 years in the Navy in my country, could come to Monterey to address you in your graduation exercise was very, very low. And if we add to that the fact that today, March 24, could be maybe the last time in my life I would wear this uniform, well, that probability a month ago was certainly zero. So this is a very special day for me, and it was not planned like this. It just happened. As many things in the world, it was unpredictable. Therefore, I do have a message for you, and I will not waste my time being politically correct, because you do not deserve that. And because I was never politically correct, and maybe that's the main reason why I had a successful career. Our war is in big trouble right now. You know it because you read the papers, have many friend deploys, watch TV, or use TikTok or Reels. And I have bad news for you. The war has been in trouble my entire 56 years of life, with more or less intensity, because we humans are not perfect. And conflict is part of our nature, and sometimes we are capable of managing that conflict or not, for many reasons. A very, very big part of the world society reasonably wants to avoid conflict and protect its state of comfort. And because of that, the others, let's call them the others, use those spaces of weaknesses or hesitation to advance with decisive action pursuing their own interests and objectives, which often conflict with ours. It is a problem of will to use our force and assume the consequence and sometimes become very bad and bloody. In game theory language, it's like playing the chicken game. I'm not gonna give it that name, it's a technical name. With a player that doesn't care too much about losing several times. That's the most predictable player. That's the worst player. This predictable player behaves in that manner until the problem becomes so big that the conflict and trouble is unavoidable, and the consequences are much bigger and much more bloody. I don't need to give you boring examples, because examples are being played on TV right now across the Atlantic. Is this a pessimistic view? Oh no, it's just realistic. That is the world you will face the rest of your career and your life. A world fighting, a world in crisis, ready to fight with very rare moments of all around peace. So the question is, what does it mean for you, American, an international student, that today you finally obtained your very valuable state-of-the-art and prestigious master's degree or PhD? What do you think about the cost of it? I guess you are aware it was paid by your citizens of your country, not by you. So I will give you some advice, and maybe you will not like some of it. And if that's the case, please send a note to the Chilean Navy, and they will probably retire me. Okay, I'm done, so I don't care. Third piece of advice, be thankful. Be thankful for your country that has provided you this magnificent education, and be aware that your country is expecting you to produce something or create something in return. If some of you want to retire from active duty, do not do it that soon, please, in search of money, because it's not the right thing to do. Almost immediately retiring after this opportunity of improving substantially your knowledge is an injustice to the people in need who are you supposed to serve as an officer of your country. Why do I say this? Because I saw this lack of commitment many times during my life in service. Officers receiving a very big opportunity to grow, to do something better, and once they are done and receive their deserved diplomas, immediately quit and go to a private company. Our countries do not deserve that, my opinion. Be thankful for your parents, if you're lucky enough to have them alive, for making you a good person and for giving you the opportunity to grow. Tell them you love them for being brave and generous enough to raise kids, including yourself. Be thankful for your spouses, if you have one. If you don't have, please look for someone immediately. Because they surely supported you unconditionally these years in Monterrey and where you were deployed away. Tell them I love you. I do love you, your sacrifice. I do value your resilience and counsel. Anita, if you are hearing, please, Lord, don't forget that. These are short phrases, but they are really meaningful right now, more than tomorrow. Tomorrow might be late. Be thankful with God if you believe in him, and I don't need to explain why. Second piece of advice, dear officers, be humble. When I was here, I realized that the more I studied complex linear algebra, stochastic models, advanced simulation of probabilities, the more I learned that there's so much I didn't know I probably never could. In your way, you will find many arrogant intellectuals or arrogant officers that want to give you lessons on how the science and the world works, just to realize when put them to the test that they were wrong. Be humble and aware that the path of knowledge is endless. Be humble also will get the sympathy of your bosses and the admiration of the most of the people you command. Be aware being humble doesn't mean lack of character. And character is a must for you as a leader. Third bit of advice, foster teamwork. Discussing as a team is one of the best ways for overcoming your own weaknesses. Maybe you believe yourself to be an expert in a specific topic, but teamwork and common sense will help you to find what you could do better and to reveal your own mistakes and shortcomings. There is nothing harder, no more uncomfortable than being the only one that understands a complex topic and face a critical decision-making situation about that particular topic with you as the only advisor. Because if you are wrong, people may die. And you, knowing yourself, also know in the bottom of your heart that you do mistakes, or not, very frequently. When your people feel that they are part of a solid and well-led team, potential resentment disappears. And resentment is the worst, most potential sickness of the soul and the society. And I believe to be one of the most detrimental, powerful tools of the forces of evil. So get rid of the resentment of the people that you know. Four P's, dare to be critic. There are some people that even in their 30s enjoy having a low profile or even a little bit shy as an officer. Well, if that is the case, those days must go away right now for two reasons. First, because you are an officer, and you must act according to your status. And second, because you are fully loaded with the best knowledge in the world. If you graduated from here, the NPS, you are supposed to be capable of adding value to everything you do. And certainly you are, trust yourself. You are also supposed to be loaded with critical thinking skills. You have to learn to be critical, respectful, and judicious. When being a critic, be also smart, looking that there is a right moment, the right words, and the right attitude in which to be critical. Being critical doesn't mean to be suicidal in a meeting or in a briefing, but time and deliver your criticism in a smart and effective manner. Fifth or sixth, be brutally honest when necessary. In the core of our career, we are fighting. There is no place for being politically correct. The world is sick and tired of political correctness that hides the truth by avoiding certain discussions or avoiding being subject to criticism. This is a societal sickness, particularly complex over the last 30 years, where searching for the truth seems less important than being politically correct. You, military officers, cannot fall into that trap. Your job is of life or death. And if you are not capable of telling the truth, what you believe is the fundamental truth, even though most people or even your boss won't like it, then you are a below standard officer. I believe. Final piece of advice. Be a leader. Don't forget that even though you have received the gift of a very sophisticated technical knowledge, you are a leader, not a technician. Therefore, use your brand new knowledge to get the best from the system and people under your command. Take care of your people, and your people will take care of you. And if you're doing well as a leader, it will be the case that your name will be mentioned by the families of those you lead in their dining tables during Sunday lunch. They will say, "Honey, you know what? Your commander is really a very good, qualified, humble team leader, a critical and honest officer, and honey, if you go to war with him or her, you will surely survive and come back home, sweetie." If you get those families to talk about you in that way, then you are doing a good job. Dear officers, our career is not simple. It may be challenging and discouraging at the time, but I promise you, if you commit completely with passion and giving the most you can to the people under your command, you will reach the end of your career with the sensation of having accomplished your goals, your duties, and having served your country as your country deserves. And you will be a retired old man and woman, and your people will see you in the supermarket, the park, in the hospital in your wheelchair, and instead of avoiding you, they will come to you and hold you with respect and gratitude. And that sensation, fellow, is sublime. Admiral Rondeau, Admiral Mustin, Dr. Garnett, Admiral Aiken, I don't consider this award as my award. This is an award for my country, and especially for my Navy. I humbly thank you for this great honor and responsibility. God bless you all. God bless our country. Thank you.
I'm honored once again to introduce the president of the Naval Postgraduate School, Vice Admiral Ann Rondo.
Wow. That was, aren't we happy to have him be one of our favorites? Yep, you get pretty inspired when you hear a leader talk about leadership in such a real human way. So thank you, Admiral, for connecting us to who we are and what we're about. So now I have the pleasure and the honor of introducing another great leader. Vice Admiral Mustin is a surface warfare officer with afloat service on Aegis cruisers and destroyers, and command experience of the 04, 05, 06, and flag level strike group levels. As Commander Expeditionary Group 2, he had 14 ships, 10 shore commands, 25,000 sailors and Marines, and he currently serves as our 15th Chief of Naval Reserve and the Commander of the Navy Reserve Force, leading over 100,000 sailors, and is now, as of yesterday, a distinguished graduate of NPS. But he's not the first in his family to make Vice Admiral. He's the third. So we heard from Admiral Soto about his story about being the son of actually their version of MCPON, of the Master Chief of the Navy for Chile. Admiral Mustin goes back to 1896. Well, not him, but his family. So the Admiral's great-grandfather, Henry C. Mustin, joined the Navy in 1896, rising to the rank of captain. He's often referred to as the father of naval aviation for establishing the Navy's first permanent air station and being its first commanding officer. Then Captain Mustin's eldest son, Lloyd Mustin, rose to the rank of Vice Admiral and took part in developing the Navy's first lead computing anti-aircraft gun sight, which of course proved of major importance in World War II. Vice Admiral Lloyd Mustin had two sons, both of whom continued their family's rank of Vice Admiral, of the Naval Service. One of them, Henry C. Mustin, for whom I had the pleasure of serving for a short period of time, also rose to the rank of Vice Admiral and was a decorated and very well-known at the time Vietnam veteran and served as a Deputy Chief of Naval Operations for Plans and Policy. Two of Vice Admiral Hank Mustin's sons served in the Navy, and we have one of them right here, John. Okay, so let me now go to his thesis. Everybody who comes up to the stage gets their thesis. And I never ask what they got for grades, so don't worry about it. Okay, so his was evaluating, this is really actually very important. Evaluating carrier battlegroup anti-air warfare capability in a computer-aided exercise, and the objective of the thesis was to develop an exercise analysis methodology for evaluating the execution of joint tasks during the conduct of computer-aided exercises. And you say, well, okay, that was great back then. This past week, we've been talking about how we do real-time adjudication and understanding exercises and doing that kind of work so that we understand what is going on. And the Admiral was one of the lead thought leaders in all of that. So we have, in one way, the great Admiral Soto earning such praise and such respect for leading his Navy. I now want to introduce to you an equally terrifically nice man and a great leader, Admiral John Mustin.
Well, good morning, students, distinguished guests, Naval Postgraduate School faculty and staff, family, friends, and all of our supporters who are with us today. I am thrilled and honored to join you for what's a very special day for our Navy, our Marine Corps, our Army, our Air Force, our close international partners, the storied institution, and of course, our soon-to-be graduates, 163 of which are assembled here. Admiral Rondo, thank you for the invitation. And thank you for your poignant opening remarks and your due diligence on my family history. Vice Admiral Soto, thank you for joining us today and for being a shining example of the very best of our operations research family and a great international partner. Congratulations again on your induction this morning into the NPS Hall of Fame. Well, it is a real pleasure for me to be here as we mark the important transition in the professional and personal lives of the 163 outstanding individuals before us today, as well as those of the 55 graduates unable to join us in person. You are all an incredible group, on the verge of completing a professionally rewarding education, and perhaps more importantly, on the verge of returning to your ships, your squadrons, battalions, and units, armed with a world-renowned graduate education. This is a momentous day for all of you. It's a proud day. You've worked hard and you've likely overcome many obstacles, not the least of which were academic. The fact that you're here today celebrating this moment is a remarkable achievement in itself, but make no mistake, your real work starts today. 27 years ago, when I stood in your shoes, eagerly awaiting my opportunity to cross the stage as an aspiring operations research graduate, the world was a very different place. The Navy I had joined just a few years prior in 1990 had recently liberated Kuwait during Operation Desert Storm, and the 1991 collapse of the Soviet Union had ushered in the end of the Cold War and the beginning of a new era, a unipolar political reality in which the U.S. was the world's only superpower. Overnight, we found ourselves facing a different, very different security environment, one characterized by regional and transnational rather than global threats. In response, the Navy developed a new strategy called From the Sea, which emphasized littoral warfare and maneuver. And with even nearly 600 ships, can you imagine? 600 ships. Our Navy and our Marine Corps team was busy. It was operational, forward deployed, and relevant. Today, three decades later, the world has changed again. Our U.S. Navy is 50% smaller than it was in those glory days. Not surprisingly, it remains operational and relevant, and even more busy. And the lessons I learned as a student here, in my classes with esteemed Captain Wayne Meyer, the legendary author of Fleet Tactics, were equally as important to me as a department head as they were later as a strike group commander. And you will find the same. As you prepare to rejoin the fleet or your respective services, after this period of intense academic immersion, we're counting on you to apply what you learned with urgency to make our joint and coalition forces stronger, better, more adaptable, because the world dynamic continues to change. And let's be clear, based on historical norms, today's security environment is increasingly competitive. It's faster paced, it's more complex than even 5 short years ago. And the things you studied here are even more in demand, more important, and more critical path to global stability than ever. One need only peruse the headlines to grasp the fragility of the rules-based international order. In the past 3 years alone, we've experienced a sea change. The recognition that we have transitioned from the global war on terror to an enduring period of strategic competition, defined by critical, combustible, and a dynamic decade. And our efforts today will shape the maritime balance of power and strengthen our nation's and our partners' nations' global standing for the remainder of this century. In addition to the conflict in Ukraine, we see provocative behavior in the Atlantic, the Pacific, the South China Sea, the East China Sea, the Red Sea, Arabian Gulf, Baltic, Black Sea, Arctic, and every international choke point that impacts global international commerce. We're not admiring the problem. In fact, we're aggressively modernizing our Navy, our Marine Corps, and our joint warfighting team to address the realities of today's global environment. We're building new capabilities, things that didn't even exist when I was a student, and we're shifting capacity to meet the needs of long-term strategic competition. We can no longer wake up hoping that tomorrow looks like yesterday, because it won't. We recognize the need to transform, to innovate, to make hard decisions, to prioritize what matters, and to shed legacy processes, force structure, and expectations. And we're doing this with urgency, to prepare for the future. And that's where you come in. Your time here was an investment in you. You're serving in an incredibly exciting and a consequential time, and our future is dependent upon your good thinking and your leadership. I've said many times before that our military services have much to be proud of, and yet we still have much to do. Our track record of innovation is impressive, but prior achievements are no guarantee of success in the future. America thrives because of its recognition and its appreciation of the importance of international partners and global coalitions. And make no mistake, ladies and gentlemen, America loves, deserves, and expects winners. And as you rejoin your operational forces, the nation is depending on you to apply what you learned here, to immediately contribute and deliver integrated all-domain military power, and to maintain a clear-eyed resolve to compete, deter, and decisively win today. Victory in battle is neither a coincidence nor a God-given right. It takes work and the application of the decision-making that is the product of this fine institution. I hope you recharged your batteries and you spent quality time with family and friends during your time in Monterey. I certainly don't intend to characterize your time here as a walk in the park. In fact, I know from my own experiences in Glasgow Hall that the academic rigor was non-trivial. But nonetheless, it may still be the greatest deal in the Navy. Even when I was a lieutenant, my wife and I were smart enough to know and even recognize then that we might not ever have it this good again. We lived in La Mesa, which, by the way, has been completely modernized since we were there. In fact, I drove by last night to check on it, and my house on Wilkes Lane no longer exists. But back then, I was in shape, my handicap was low, and miraculously, my wife and I escaped without any of what we called at the time the 3 Ds. I hear now that you all talk about the 5 Ds, and I mentioned yesterday, I think that's just another example of inflation. And frankly, we just assumed that things like degrees and diplomas were a given. So, but thankfully, none of the 3 Ds. And I would just offer now, you are about to embark on a well-deserved celebration. And after the celebratory dust is settled, after you've rehydrated, you've taken some Tylenol, deleted your social media accounts, after today, you'll return to the fleet. And you're going to deploy away from your family and friends. You're going to endure long days. You're going to adjudicate challenges and execute difficult decisions. Decisions that may hold life in the balance. And there will be no shortage of these challenges along the way in a fruitful career. But back to our investment in you. You're prepared. Be confident in your approach to problem solving and to leadership and to addressing any challenges. I hope you realize that they are simply opportunities to overcome. But I hope you also recognize that your decisions are going to create the difference between success and failure. And I want to remind you that failure in our business is not an option. As NPS graduates, you're members of an elite fraternity and a sorority. You're well armed for any challenges that you may face. This fine institution holds a globally recognized reputation, without peer, relative to integrating a world-class education, interdisciplinary research, cutting-edge practical application, and a commitment to solving real-world, tangible, complex military problems. The degrees that you receive today will allow you to operate and thrive with intellectual agility in an increasingly complex and challenging security environment. Precisely the type of real-world, relevant, technological leadership that our future force demands. So momentarily, you're going to receive your diplomas. And on the surface, it's a modest piece of sheepskin. But in reality, it's an important credential certifying that you have successfully completed the arduous course of study here at NPS and representing your dedication to expanding your thinking and your investment in the furtherance of continued service. And while this may be the last thing you want to hear on graduation day, I will offer that you must never stop learning. Commit yourself to applying what you learned in the classrooms and the lecture halls in the Naval Postgraduate School. Commit yourselves to mastering your tradecraft and to learning and to problem solving and to taking care of your soldiers, sailors, airmen, Coast Guards, men and women, guardians, Marines. I don't think we have any guardians here today. But also commit yourselves to the relentless pursuit of lifelong learning. In closing and here and speaking from personal experience, as the years pass and the memories fade, as my great friend Jim Akin said already, it's doubtful that you're going to remember much of anything that I said here. But I hope you'll remember one thing. I will foot stomp a great quote from Admiral Bull Halsey, himself a legendary warfighter. There are no extraordinary people. just extraordinary circumstances that ordinary people are forced to deal with. It's up to you. It's up to you to be bold enough to use those extraordinary circumstances to bring out the extraordinary talent in the men and women you lead, and to find victory in the trials that you're going to face together as a team. So after you leave this ceremony and before you report to your next assignment, take some time to think about the type of leader that you expect to be and want to be. How will you lead, and how will you make sure that your team is ready to contribute now to ensure the enduring prosperity of our nation, and frankly, the free world in this decisive decade? Our investment in your world-class education gives you many tools, but it also imposes expectations. You know we're counting on you. It's a weighty burden, but this is one that you are well prepared to carry, thanks to your time here at NPS. As you continue to lead day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, you're each going to grow, and you will impact many lives, and you will experience what I have found to be the most rewarding and satisfying profession in this great world. So to each of you, congratulations. I wish you the very best. I'm supremely proud to serve alongside each and every one of you, and I look forward to seeing you in the fleet. And finally, to our hosts and our guests, our families, our NPS team, our friends and supporters here to celebrate these superb graduates, thank you. I offer my sincere thanks for what each of you do in the fleet and for what the rest of you do, whether that's at home or elsewhere. And for all of you, thank you for your continued support of our sailors, soldiers, airmen, Marine, Coast Guard men and women, and guardians. All right, I've talked long enough. It's time to get busy. We're gonna get to the important part of this ceremony. Let me close by saying, God bless you all. And may God bless our Navy, our Marine Corps, our U.S. Army, our Space Force, our Joint Force, our Air Force, our many international partners, and may God continue to bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Okay.
I would now like to invite forward President Rondeau, Vice Admiral Soto, Vice Admiral Mustin, and Admiral Aiken for the presentation of awards. Degrees, excuse me. Will the candidate for the degree Doctor of Philosophy please stand and proceed to the platform?
Chief Warrant Officer 4, Judy Esquibel, from the Department of Information Sciences, the candidate for the degree Doctor of Philosophy in Information Science, please cross the stage. The title of Chief Warrant Officer 4's Esquibel's dissertation is Willingness to Partner in Public-Private Partnerships for Cybersecurity of Critical Infrastructure. Chief Warrant Officer 4 Esquibel's advisor is Professor Dan Boger, from the Department of Information Sciences. Chief Warrant Officer 4 Esquibel's research focused on exploring how public and private organizations develop a willingness to partner. Through her study, she developed a process model that highlights the dynamic nature of building willingness and how it involves ongoing engagement, commitment, and collaboration. Her findings contribute to the existing literature on public-private partnerships in the field of cybersecurity. President Rondeau, I present to you Chief Warrant Officer 4 Esquibel. She has completed all requirements prescribed by the faculty and is recommended for the degree Doctor of Philosophy in Information Science.
By the authority vested in me, I confer upon you the degree Doctor of Philosophy with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereunto pertaining.
Thank you.
Will the candidates for the degrees Master of Arts, Master of Science, and Executive Master of Business Administration please stand?
President Rondeau, I present to you these candidates. After consideration of their academic accomplishments, the Academic Council will recommend them for the degree Masters of Arts, Masters of Science, and Executive Masters of Business Administration as specified.
Upon the recommendation of the Academic Council, I will, upon the authority vested in me, confer upon them the degree Master of Arts, Master of Science, and Executive Master of Business Administration as specified, with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereunto pertaining.
Remaining candidates, please be seated. Graduating with the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Middle East, South Asia, Sub-Saharan Africa, Lieutenant Jose Gonzalez, United States Navy. Lieutenant William Oakley, United States Navy. Graduating with an outstanding thesis and receiving the Lewis D. Liskin Award for Excellence in Regional Security Studies, Lieutenant Commander Philip Watterson, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, East Asia and the Indo-Pacific, and graduating with distinction, Captain Andy Lai, United States Army. Lieutenant Commander Sean Boyd, United States Navy. Graduating with distinction and receiving the Monterey Peninsula Council of the Navy League, Lieutenant Commander Tom Winant, Highest Academic Achievement Award, Lieutenant Jenka Brock, United States Navy. Receiving the Naval Postgraduate School Superior Service Award, Lieutenant Ashley Fishman, United States Navy. Lieutenant John Morin, United States Navy. Graduating with the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Western Hemisphere, Major Hugo Bustamante, United States Air Force. Captain Benedict Cosilo, United States Army. Lieutenant Benjamin Rollin, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Europe and Eurasia, Captain Reed Malzo, United States Army. Receiving the United States Army General Joseph W. Stilwell Chapter Award for Outstanding Army Student, Major Nathan Schaffner, United States Army. Lieutenant David Pry, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Civil Military Relations, Lieutenant Colonel Subhash Khadka, Nepali Army. With the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Strategic Studies, Major Ganchulun Torbat, Mongolian Army. Major Unkumbayar Zartbatur, Mongolian Army. With the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Homeland Security and Defense, Lieutenant Michael Komzelman, United States Navy. Lieutenant Andrew Santa Croce, United States Navy. Graduating with the degree Master of Arts in Security Studies, Combating Terrorism Policy and Strategy, and receiving the International Student Award for Excellence in Regional or Security Studies, and recognized for an outstanding thesis, Lieutenant Colonel Mohamed El Amin Brahim El Kahil Raghizi, Algerian Air Force. Lieutenant Colonel Abdelmek Boudieff, Algerian Navy. Mr. Jared Babin, Transportation Security Administration, Texas. Graduating with a degree, Master of Arts in Security Studies, Homeland Security and Defense, Captain Evan Balcombe, New York City Fire Department. Captain James Bassett, Oakland Police Department, California. Assistant Fire Chief Colin Burris, Memphis Fire Department. Superintendent Surendra Ranjit, Armed Police Force, Nepal. Mr. Thomas Chin, City of Cupertino, California. Dr. Shruti Dapodkar, San Mateo County, California. Captain Christopher Dorsey, Metropolitan Police Department, Washington, D.C. Special Agent William Elliott, United States Secret Service, Washington, D.C. Lieutenant Commander Laura Vandekar Hill, California Highway Patrol. Lieutenant Andrew Horos, Metropolitan Police Department, Washington, D.C. Receiving the Curtis H. Butch Straub Achievement Award and recognized with distinction and an outstanding thesis, Special Agent Christopher Hoon, Minnesota Commerce Fraud Bureau. Mr. Michael Matthews, Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, Nevada. Mrs. Madison Miller, Missouri State Highway Patrol. Lieutenant Jonathan Moritz, New York City Fire Department. Ms. Catherine Norris, South Carolina Emergency Management Division. Officer Elizabeth O'Malley, United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, Washington, D.C. Ms. Susan Papatrefone, Southeastern Arizona Communications. Mr. Stephen Patterson, West Virginia Fusion Center. Assistant Chief Stephen Ramos, California Highway Patrol. Captain Nicholas Riddall, Los Angeles County City Fire Department. Ms. Sashi Sabratnam, University of California Cooperative Extension, Sonoma County. Lieutenant Joseph Sembler, New Jersey State Police. Chief of Police Eric Shipman, Chicago Federal Reserve. Supervisory Federal Air Marshal Jason Strickland, Federal Air Marshal Service, Washington, D.C. Officer Emily Von Wellhoff, United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, New York. Mr. Daniel White, Denver Police Department. Officer Kirsten Whitehead, United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, Maryland. Graduating with a degree, Master of Science in Electrical Engineering, Lieutenant Simon Finney, United States Navy. Lieutenant John Martin II, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Science in Meteorology, Second Lieutenant Dean Nicholas Candelario, United States Air Force. With the degree Master of Science in Physical Oceanography, and graduating with distinction and recognized for an outstanding thesis, Lieutenant Patrick James Collins, Royal Australian Navy. Major Pua So Bing, Republic of Singapore Navy. With the degree Master of Science in Applied Physics, receiving the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory Award for Excellence in Applied Physics Research, Lieutenant Christopher Michael Griggs, United States Navy. Way to go. with the degree Master of Science in Mechanical Engineering and receiving the Chief of Naval Operations Undersea Warfare Award, Lieutenant Keegan William Delanoy, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Science in Computer Science, Captain Jacob Slaughter, United States Marine Corps. Captain Georgios Andriopoulos, Hellenic Navy. Major Alexander Golovko, Ukrainian Ground Forces. Graduating with the Rear Admiral Grace Murray Hopper Computer Science Award, Lieutenant Commander Matthew Akers, United States Navy. Lieutenant Brian Harrington, United States Navy. Lieutenant Grant Knott, United States Navy. Lieutenant Justin Loomis, United States Navy. Mr. Paul Dewey III. Mr. Sean Kalis. Mr. Tarun Menon. With the degree Master of Science in Defense Analysis, Major Ishmael Adif, Maldives National Defense Force, Marine Corps. Major Sebastian Madalin Baban, Romanian Land Forces. Graduating with an outstanding thesis, Commander Wirasundagrainge Dharmarathne, Sri Lankan Navy. Graduating with the Naval Postgraduate School Outstanding Academic Achievement Award for International Students, Commander Abubakar Sadiq Nura, Nigerian Navy. Graduating with distinction, Lieutenant Colonel Matthias Schwarzbauer, German Army. With the degree Master of Science in Operations Research and graduating with distinction, right. Lieutenant Jeremy Berg, United States Navy. Lieutenant Timothy Burnett, United States Navy. Receiving the Captain David S. Bill Jr. Leadership Award, Lieutenant Crystal Cornine, United States Navy. Graduating with an outstanding thesis and receiving the Chief of Naval Operations Award for Excellence in Operations Research, Lieutenant Thomas Economidis, United States Navy. Graduating with an outstanding thesis and receiving the Military Operations Research Society Stephen A. Tisdale Graduate Research Award, Lieutenant Felicia Goodell, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Rohan Kulkarni, Indian Navy. Lieutenant Commander Philip Lukanich, United States Navy. Lieutenant Ned Nicholson, United States Navy. Lieutenant Kyle Plunkett, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander John Ramage, United States Navy. Commander Kevin Francis Riley, United States Navy. Lieutenant Jacob Schaefer, United States Navy. With an outstanding thesis, Lieutenant Commander Alexander Cooper, United States Navy. With an outstanding thesis and receiving the Surface Navy Association's Award for Excellence in Surface Warfare Research, Lieutenant Commander Emmett Delatour, United States Navy. Mr. Jacob Weigel, Naval Postgraduate School. With the degree Master in Cost Estimating and Analysis, Ms. Emily Baxter, Air Force Material Command, Air Force Research Laboratory. Ms. Tonia Bell, Naval Engineering Logistics Office. Ms. Elise Featherman, Naval Air Systems Command. Graduating with distinction, Ms. Krista Gaspard, Naval Air Systems Command. Mr. James Machado, Air Force Material Command, Air Force Lifecycle Management Center, Financial Management. Mrs. Kathleen Roche, Naval Surface Warfare Center, Philadelphia Division. With the degree Master of Systems Analysis, Lieutenant Taylor Alvarez, United States Navy. With the degree Master of Science in Systems Engineering and graduating with distinction, Major Daniel Jewett, United States Marine Corps. Graduating with the Meyer Award for Outstanding Student in Systems Engineering Distance Learning, Lieutenant Brianna Lucia Videras, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Chase Windsor, United States Navy. Mrs. Sarah Brown, Naval Undersea Warfare Development Center, Division Newport. Graduating with distinction and receiving the Meyer Award for Outstanding Student in Systems Engineering Distance Learning, Mr. Jamie Donay, Naval Undersea Warfare Center, Division Newport. With the degree Master of Science in Systems Engineering, Captain Soon Jung Na, Republic of Korea Army. With the degree Master of Science in Network Operations and Technology, Captain Thomas McAtee, United States Army. With the degree Master of Science in Space Systems Operations, graduating with the Air Force Association Award for Advancement of Aerospace Studies, Major Juliano Freitas Batista de Oliveira, Brazilian Air Force. Graduating with an outstanding thesis and receiving the Air Force Association Award for Outstanding U.S. Air Force Student, Major Alexander Denton, United States Air Force. Lieutenant Colonel John Mattson, United States Air Force. Lieutenant Commander Matthew Frank, United States Navy. With the degree Executive Master of Business Administration, Major Steve Angeline, United States Marine Corps. Lieutenant Colonel Jonathan Brandt, United States Marine Corps. Lieutenant Sierra Black Scott, United States Navy. Captain Monticola Bowman, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Sebastian Garcia, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Christopher Walton, United States Navy. Ms. Maria Bahia, Navy Strategic Systems Programs. Ms. Rona Shimon Bronridge, Naval Information Warfare Systems Command Headquarters. Mr. Francisco Seha, Naval Information Warfare Systems Command. Ms. Molly K. Hobbs, Navy Systems Management Activity. Mrs. Crystal Keisha Fern Jackson, Naval Facilities Engineering Systems Command, Atlantic. Ms. Carlene Moran, Naval Information Warfare Systems Command. Mr. Thomas Netzel, Naval Supply Systems Command, Weapon Systems Support. With the degree Master of Science in Management, Defense Systems Analysis, Captain Diego Alvarez, United States Marine Corps. Major Sean Avery, United States Marine Corps. Major Timothy Beebe, United States Marine Corps. Graduating with distinction and receiving the Marine Corps Association Superior Service Award for Outstanding U.S. Marine Student, Captain Robert Runnels III, United States Marine Corps. With an outstanding thesis, Captain Timothy Soki, United States Marine Corps. Also receiving the degree Master of Science in Systems Engineering Management, Lieutenant Colonel Stephen Strebe, United States Marine Corps. Captain Brennan Wade Strobel, United States Marine Corps. Major Brandon Sullivan, United States Marine Corps. With an outstanding thesis, Major Aaron Falk, United States Marine Corps. Captain Emily Hastings, United States Marine Corps. Major Michael Haynes, United States Marine Corps. Graduating with distinction, recognized for an outstanding thesis, and receiving the Chief of Naval Personnel Award for Academic Excellence in Manpower Systems Analysis, Captain Jennifer Marks, United States Marine Corps. Major Mark Allen McGee, United States Marine Corps. Graduating with the Department of Defense Management Faculty Outstanding International Student Award, Major Lincoln Sudholtz, Australian Army. Lieutenant Commander Jacob Black, United States Navy. With an outstanding thesis, Lieutenant Commander Eric Campbell, United States Navy. Lieutenant Stephen Gagnon, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Juanita Hopkins, United States Navy. Lieutenant Alan Lee, United States Navy. Lieutenant Decretia Nolan, United States Navy. Lieutenant Wesley Norton, United States Navy. Lieutenant Maxine Camille Robinson, United States Navy. Lieutenant Commander Joshua Blair Joseph Neal, United States Navy Reserve. Captain Darrell Weaver, United States Air Force. Please join me in giving all of our graduates a well-deserved round of applause. Please stand for the benediction.
Receive the benediction. God of grace, God of glory, the rewarder of all who seek you, and the giver of contentment to those who trust in you, bless us now with renewed confidence and peace. Work in us and through the Naval Postgraduate School, now and until kingdom come. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's graduation ceremony. On behalf of the President, Provost, and all of us at the Naval Postgraduate School, I'd like to thank you once again for being here today. We also offer our sincere appreciation to the Naval Postgraduate School Color Guard and the Del Monte Brass. Please remain clear of the aisles until the platform party and faculty have departed. On behalf of the Naval Postgraduate School Foundation, I'd also like to invite graduates, faculty, and guests to reception in honor of the graduates in the Barbara McNitt Ballroom in Herman Hall immediately following the ceremony. Thank you.